Good afternoon. Thank you so much for coming. I really do appreciate the support. When I started thinking about what I wanted to do research on about a year ago, for ultimately my capstone, as well as the historical methods and research class, the first big decision I had to make was what I wanted to research on. Obviously, because I was going to be spending many months working on it, I wanted it to be something that I'm passionate about. So for me, it turned into a no-brainer that my mind started drifting towards ministry for a couple of reasons. One, as someone who wants to be ordained as a priest in the Episcopal Church, ministry is kind of important, which also led to the question of a woman's role within the church. And once again, a no-brainer, because just to state the obvious, clearly, I'm a woman. And when it comes to a woman's role in the church, that has been a hotly debated, controversial topic since the early days in the church, even down to the days of Christ. And I don't think anyone put it better than Catherine Mumford Booth, who said that, and we find from church history that the primitive Christians thus understood it, for that women did actually speak and preach amongst them. We have indisputable proof. God had promised in the last days to pour out his spirit upon all flesh, and that the daughters, as well as the sons of mankind, should prophesy. She took this from a passage in the Old Testament from the book of Joel that says, word for word, that the spirit will be passed down to the sons and the daughters, and that both will prophesy. So, sorry guys, it's not just the men who get to prophesy in the last days. And the indisputable proof that Catherine is referring to can be found all over the New Testament, particularly in the ministry of Jesus Christ himself. Women had a very strong role in their witnessing through his ministry, even the day of the resurrection. Particularly in John's Gospel, we see Jesus approaching a Samaritan woman at the town well in the middle of the day. This is significant for two reasons. One, as a Samaritan, this is the only time this woman could come out, because in Jewish society, you would not have dealings with a Samaritan if you were in fact Jewish, which forced this woman as an outcast to come during the hottest part of the day to get her water. This is also significant because after Jesus has a conversation with this woman, he tells her to go into the town, preach to the men, round them up, and bring them back to the well so that Jesus could preach to them. Of course, she obeyed. And not only did the men listen to her, they actually followed her back to the well where Jesus was waiting to preach to them. This is very significant because this is a woman actively preaching, actively proselytizing. The very essence of ministry is being told in this story. And then even in Paul's ministry, women had a part to play, particularly Priscilla and Aquila and Junian Andronicus. Even in the New Greek, there was a very interesting detail. Usually, when it comes to ministerial teams, especially when they are run by spouses, it was customary for the husband to be addressed first. But in both cases, it was the lady that was addressed first, which means two things. One, she's the leader of the outfit. And two, for her to have that much of an emphasis in Paul's book, that meant she had to be extraordinary. In fact, he praised both Priscilla and Junia as being the apostles above all other apostles. Pretty sweet setup for the ladies. But then, when you take those passages, we've got a little bit of a puzzle here, because also within the Pauline letters are these two passages where the writer speaks to the churches in Corinth and Ephesus that women should be silent in church and that women should be submissive and not have authority over men. So the puzzle is, why would women play such an active role in Jesus' ministry and in Paul's ministry, and yet one would have to reconcile that to the fact that someone said these two things to the women? So it boils down to a single question: who should serve? Who should lead? Who should have a serving place in the ministry of Jesus Christ? There is another passage in the Gospel, particularly John chapter 4, that speaks of the white fields of harvest in ministry. The important thing about this field is, even for women, the field is very much a white harvest, and the future gleaners are the ones who are able to benefit from the labors of those who came before them. And for women today, they can thank the following women for their opportunities today. And that is McCrean of Cappadocia, Hildegard von Bingen, Bumford Booth, Catherine Bramwell Booth, and lastly, Amy Semple McPherson. McCrean of Cappadocia, also known as McCrean the Younger, had a very interesting role to play. She is considered one of the earliest nuns. She was an abbess of her organization. She was also a teacher and a healer that was very important in her community. Her story is interesting given the time that she lived, because at that time women were expected to marry young, have children, and serve their families until the day they die. And at the beginning, Macrina looked to be taking the same path. At the age of 12, she had flocks of suitors coming to ask for her hand, and her father eventually settled on a young relative who was studying law. But during the betrothal process, the young man unexpectedly died. And when Macrina was proposed with re-entering the field and having suitors brought before her, she refused, because as far as she was concerned, a betrothal was just as good as a marriage contract, and she felt honor-bound to honor that contract. So she took on a life of celibacy, and she spent her time getting rid of her earthly possessions. She released her servants from her service, but offered them a place to stay if they so chose. Also, as the eldest child, she also took on the task of raising and mentoring her younger brothers. You might even be aware of a couple of them, particularly Basil the Great and Gregory of Nyssa, the Cappadocian fathers. Her role in their life was significant because she was one of their greatest influences in how they viewed God, how they viewed a pure life. She had so much of a distinction in their lives that after she died, her brother Gregory wrote a tribute to her, in which he wrote, "As often happens at such time, the talk went on until we came to discuss the life of one famous person. In this case, it was a woman who provided us with our subject, if indeed she should be styled woman. For I do not know whether it is fitting to designate her by her sex, who so surpassed her sex." And so surpassed her sex, Macrina did. For a woman, she was well known in her community, and she was so loved that when she died, it took the pallbearers the better part of a day to take her body from the family estate to the church where her funeral would be held. And the mourning was great for that community. As a nun, she was able to take women into her home, and she gave them shelter, and together they formed a community where they took on different projects in the community. They taught different subjects. They also provided healing and spiritual counsel. And this set the stage for future nuns, including Hildegard von Bingen. Hildegard is a very interesting woman for quite a few reasons. One, she was a mystic, a visionary. A visionary is someone who communes with God, who sees his face and hears his voice in their life. She was also a healer, an abbess, and she was a composer of some of the most beautiful music I have ever heard. Music that wouldn't even be recognized for 100 years. So she was a trendsetter, as well as a very spiritual woman. Hildegard was the youngest of 10 children. And when she reached the age of 8, her parents, realizing that when they have 10 children, mostly daughters, there wasn't a lot they'd be able to offer to their youngest. So they dedicated her to the church as a tithing. And had her shut up with an anchoress by the name of Jutta. An anchoress is someone who basically stays within one room, usually attached to the church, and they stay there till the day they die. So she stayed in this one room with Jutta, who taught her how to read, how to pray, how to do all these different things that would be expected of her until she took the veil, which she did. When Jutta died, Hildegard was unanimously elected as abbess for the convent when she was only 26. And even in her early days, she was viewed as someone who had very many gifts, and those gifts she used to the best of her ability to take care of her young charges within the convent. And then she started getting some rather interesting ideas. She could hear God's voice in her life, and she went to her vicar and asked for something that women were not allowed to have. She asked for the right to be able to write down her visions and share them not only with the sisters of her convent, but with the general community. And after testing her and realizing that she indeed did have a gift, her vicar gave permission, and she started preaching to the community. And as her popularity grew, she started going on tours around Germany, preaching, being with the people. Her popularity grew to where the princes of the different provinces of Germany, and even Eugenius, the Pope of the time, came to Germany to see her preach. I think we can say that Hildegard pretty much had it made for making a difference for women. And then she heard the voice of God speak to her again. She heard God saying that she should pack up the sisters of her convent, move to a different location where they could be independent, so that they could make an even bigger impact on the people around them. So she went to her vicar, who at this point had been enjoying Hildegard's popularity, not to mention the considerable income that's generated when you have a prophetess within your walls. So when she went to him and said, "I would like to move the sisters to a different location," you can imagine how he reacted. He said, "No woman, no nun within her right mind would want to move to a moldy old monastery away from the conveniences and luxuries that the monastery can provide and basically be expected to live on their own." He called her a lunatic and said that she was to never bring the topic up again. Now, in the face of this kind of opposition, women have to get a little creative when it comes to dealing with the problem. Hildegard was in a state of collapse, and she was taken to her bed where she did not eat or drink for several weeks, and the vicar watched as his beloved, his beloved visionary waits before him until she was finally within a breath of death, and he begged her not to die, to get better, saying that if she recovered, not only would he allow her to go, he would help her move himself. Upon hearing these words, she was able to get out of bed as if she had never been sick. Rather wrong one goes to Hildegard. So not only did she move these sisters to a convent, which was a day's ride, 30 kilometers away from the original monastery, they set up a community of healing, of teaching, of serving. And not only did they do this by themselves, they thrived. So when you consider this legendary woman, not to mention her predecessor, you would think that it would be a foregone conclusion that women are gifted and called and anointed. Unfortunately, it was a question that was never ever answered to satisfaction, not even to Catherine Mumford's birthday. Catherine grew up in a Victorian era, highly conservative Methodist household. She was taught by her mother growing up. She was given a very strict Christian background. And one of the things that really left out to me about Catherine was she also had a severe disability. She had a severe curvature of the spine that we now know as scoliosis, which caused her pain her entire life. As someone who has issues with chronic pain, this really meant a lot to me, especially the way God called to her in her life. She married William Booth in 1855, and she told her new husband that she felt called to preach and to lead a ministry. Her husband said, "Well, I would not stop a woman from preaching under any circumstances, but I wouldn't encourage her to begin either." Now, a lot of women would have felt very down by such a lukewarm response at best, and they probably would have dropped the issue, but not Catherine. Catherine went, "Okay, fine. If that's the stance you're going to take, then I'm just going to have to show you you're wrong." So she threw herself into incredible amounts of study, and she eventually wrote a book called Female Ministry or The Woman's Right to Preach. And she presented her arguments along with making allowance for the novelty of the thing. We cannot discover anything either unnatural or immodest in a Christian woman becomingly attired, appearing on a platform or in a pulpit. By nature, she seems fitted to grace either. God has given to woman a graceful form and attitude, winning manners, persuasive speech, and above all, a finely toned emotional nature, all of which appears to us eminent natural qualifications for public speaking. Not only did her book win over so many people who were against women being ministers, she also won over her own husband, which would later come into play when they were creating the Salvation Army. An organization that is still strong today. In fact, this time of year, you usually see them ringing bells in front of different stores. And when William Booth was writing the bylaws and the code for the Salvation Army, he himself wrote that when it came to leadership and when it came to preaching appointments, women would have equal opportunities to men. This point of view not only benefited the women who would come to join the Salvation Army, it would even create a legacy that would go through their own family, particularly to her granddaughter, Catherine Bramwell Booth. Catherine was very close to her grandmother when she was young. Until Catherine Mumford died of cancer in 1890, she served as a mentor to her young granddaughter. And when Catherine Bramwell was 15, she was sworn into the Salvation Army and sent to a special academy where they trained officers. After she graduated with honors, she took on a lot of preaching appointments. She rose through the rankings very rapidly. She also went back to the academy as an instructor and a mentor, where she worked with young cadets and taught them how to be good ministers, how to serve, how to manage their time. And she tried to stay in the lives of each of her young charges. And in different letters. She would allow for them to ask questions, and she would write them back pertaining to whatever question it was they asked. And one of the questions she got a lot was, how do you deal with opposition? What do you do if you're preaching to someone who is against a woman speaking and who might speak rather ill of you? And her simple reply is one that I think we all can remember. We're supposed to show mercy. No soul was ever made poor by loving too much or injured by forgiving too often. So if someone's in your face telling you that what you're doing is sinful, that you are helping the devil, instead of getting angry, you're supposed to show mercy, love them, forgive them, and show them through simple actions that, actually, I'm pretty sure God's with us on this one. These are simple truths that I think as women we need to still keep in mind today, even in the face of our own opposition. Because the point she was trying to make is, you're not going to convince someone by bashing them about the head until they give in. Sometimes a simple and gentle approach makes all the difference in the world. And throughout Catherine's career, she was very much an advocate for women preaching. And one of the women she advocated for very strongly was our last example, Amy Semple McPherson. What can I say about Amy? Amy had a very interesting life. She grew up in a small farm in Canada. She was raised by her mother, who was a member of the Salvation Army, who left to get married, which was a decision she eventually came to regret. And she hoped that Amy would take her place. So she raised her daughter, almost grooming her, with the intention of her being sworn into the Salvation Army. By the time Amy was 5, she knew the Bible so well, she could recite chunks of chapter, even entire chapters, for guests when they would come over for dinner. But Amy definitely had a mind of her own. And when she was a teenager, she wanted to find her faith for herself and not just base it off of what mom's been telling her for the past several years. So she found her own conversion at a meeting she went to that was being run by what were called holy rollers or Pentecostalists. And this had such an impact on Amy because she went into that meeting expecting to have a laugh when she saw what was at first very frightening. People being overcome by the Spirit would fall to the ground in tremors. They would speak in tongues. They would prophesy. They would have these outward experiences of God's presence. And she was really struck when a young preacher by the name of Robert Semple got up and read from his Bible, calling to repentance those who took pleasure in idle pursuits, whether it was reading novels, dancing, listening to popular music, all things that Amy had come to enjoy as a rebellion to her mother. Amy found the desire to repent. And as she continued going to meetings against her mother's wishes, she kept praying to have the same kind of experience that she had seen these people who were feeling God's presence over and over. It finally occurred for her during a blizzard, to which her mother came to get her and told her that she was to never associate with those holy rollers again. But eventually she married. She went to China as a missionary where her husband died. She remarried to Howard McPherson, and that's when she started feeling the call to ministry. When she shared it with her husband was less than supportive. And it eventually led to her dumping him and heading to Los Angeles to pick up the work. She would often joke later in her ministry that when she rolled into Los Angeles, all she had was a beat-down car and $10 in her pocket. Amy had a passion for people. She had a passion for public speaking, And she also had a goal in mind. She would say, "What is my task? To get the gospel around the world in the shortest possible time to every man and woman and boy and girl." And she definitely knew how to get the message around the world. Amy was very much a people person. And in LA, she was within a certain culture. Hollywood is within spitting range. And the people there, they liked theater, they liked films, they liked a dramatic flair. And that is how Amy would reach them with her sermons. She had a bit of a reputation for having what my mother calls lead foot syndrome. And after she had been pulled over for speeding, she showed up at her church, the Angelus Temple. She rode into the temple on a motorcycle, dressed as a police officer, with the theme of her sermon being speeding along with God, as well as the dangers of breaking God's laws. Not only was she able to bring that dramatic flair, she was able to make the gospel come alive for people. She brought what some people considered an old rusty book and bring it to them in a way to where they could go, "You know, that applies to me. I can see where my life needs to change." And people didn't laugh at her. They were repenting. They were giving their hearts to God, all because of this woman and her slightly zany way of preaching. When you take a woman who has been so highly anointed and put them among the people, they make a difference. They really do make a difference. And for Amy, when she said she wanted to get the gospel around the world, she not only fulfilled that goal, she left a lasting impression. Millions of people every year would flock to Los Angeles, to the Angeles Temple, which she built, to hear her preach. And then she would also find in whatever spare time she had to go around the world to preach. She would bring the gospel to someone. And she created a program that we now know as the Foursquare Church, which is still very active and has a huge, huge membership today, that was focused around Jesus as the Savior, baptism, communion, and most of all, service. So when you take these four women, and in each in their own way, made a difference to the women around them, they also made a difference for us. Because of each of these women, we now have opportunities that we wouldn't have had without them. And the fruit of this harvest shows in what we have inherited today. Because as of 2015, 1 in 5 Protestant seminarians are female. 20% of the mainline Protestant evangelical churches are pastored by women, which means 1 in 10 women, I mean 1 in 10 lead pastors are female. While that may seem like not very much, a twitch in the meter, it's a number that is continually growing. And one of the things that I found most extraordinary is it's even showing up in places I wouldn't have expected. For instance, earlier this year, Pope Francis announced that he was going to form a committee to discuss the potential of ordaining women as deacons, and potentially maybe even priests, which means that for the Catholic women who want to preach and make a difference, there is a door that is starting to open for them in the oldest Christian religion in the world. Think about that. So by inheriting the mantle, we have to ask ourselves, what are we going to do now? How are we going to help the women of future generations who also feel called to preach and to serve others and bring them the message of Christ. So the question I wanted, that we asked at the beginning was, who should preach? Who should lead? Who should serve? I found the answer in Romans 12. So who should teach? Whoever has the gift of teaching should teach. Who should help? Whoever has the gift of giving to help others should give generously. Who should lead? Whoever has the gift of leading should work hard at it. Whoever has the gift. So if any woman in this room feels the voice of God saying, I want you to be a minister, I want you to serve my children, listen to it. I can assure you, it's not wrong. It's biblical, it's sound. It was used by our Savior himself. Women were some of his most strongest disciples. So if you feel God calling in your heart that he wants you to serve his children in ministry, listen. Because if you have the gift, God will use your gifts to benefit his children and to bring the message of his son to every heart. Thank you. Now, before I open the floor for questions, I do have a couple things I'd like to say. I'm sure that, Haley and Anna, that you would agree with me that we could have never have done these projects if it wasn't for the professors who drove us every step of the way, encouraged us, challenged us, maybe even sometimes exasperated us. So I would like to take this time to thank Dr. Guess for your support, for your constantly being there to make sure that I was on the right path and encouraging me in my own calling. I would also like to thank Dr. Marianne Winter-Messier for her encouragement, for keeping me on my toes, and for helping me create my presentation. So would you all join me in thanking both of these wonderful people? Any questions?
Technical question, what is an abbess?
An abbess is someone who's in charge of a convent.
Okay. I knew something along the way, but I'm like, I like an abbess, and then I'm like, I don't know what an abbess does either, so I'm going to tell you.
I wonder why you didn't bring some of Hildebert's music, Christy. Not enough time.
She has a time.
Put it this way, I could have spent the better part of a week just on Hildegard alone.
Oh, yeah. All that stuff has been kind of recreated on CD. I think there's about 10 CDs that Hildegard, she's on her way to getting a gold record. She's already got a few. There's also a morality play, and she was the first one to pioneer in this kind of drama. It was real popular in the Middle Ages, a way of dramatizing the gospel. So she's pioneering in all these different ways, writing new kinds of music, kind of figuring out ways of dramatizing the gospel, and including something that didn't reappear for another 100 years. So she's quite important in many, many ways. Medicine, musical composition. She was incredible. It's just hard to believe that somebody as gifted would have been silenced. But sometimes the gift is so overflowing, you can't restrain it. And I think that's what she would say. It's like Jesus, you know, if I tell these people to shut their mouths, then the stones would cry out. Mm-hmm. Something like that. along those lines.
Yeah, she also wrote, you know, a huge number of letters and giving advice and basically telling what to do to people like archbishops and, you know, so minor dignitaries. The bit about her being very sick reminded me of when Dorothy Day was founding the Catholic Worker Movement. The bishop, I think, in New York City refused to allow it there, and she was very obedient, but she mentioned that the Bishop of Brooklyn would welcome her. And since New York City has two different bishops, okay, well, fine.
Yes, sometimes women do have to get creative when there's a huge obstacle in their path. Hildegard and Julian of Norwich, who was an anchoress and a very powerful anchoress at that. As much as I love her story, Hildegard spoke to me more. But you're right, there is a long list of women that just make me one of those cases of I'm unworthy to dust their shoes sort of thing.
Well-organized and well-researched presentation. Fascinating to listen to.
Thank you.
Thank you.